Thank you for viewing this YouTube archive of a Conscious Consumer Network broadcast. Please feel free to share it far and wide. Check out our weekly broadcast guide for weekly updates on scheduled broadcasts. Help keep us on the air by contributing to our network support fund. You can follow us on Facebook and Twitter, or get in touch via email. We thank you for supporting free and independent media.
This is For the Love of Learning, Voices of the Alternative Education Movement. Be inspired by the voices of visionaries, changemakers, and ordinary, extraordinary people who do what they do all for the love of learning.
This is For the Love of Learning, Voices of the Alternative Education Movement. I'm Lady Liberty, and this is episode number 53. In tonight's episode, we take a look at storytelling as education. Throughout history, humans have told stories, sharing their experiences, hopes, and dreams. These narratives distill human thoughts, fears, and beliefs that help to shape our understanding of the world around us. Storytelling connects us to our own humanity by linking our past and providing a glimpse into our collective futures. Storytelling makes sense out of chaos and connects us all to our human spirit. Storytelling provides meaning through form, a recognizable beginning, middle, and end, allowing us to reflect on our stories too. Storytellers entertain us and educate us, allowing us to reflect on our own stories too. And storytellers and stories are what makes us human. This is why the world needs storytellers. Tonight, we speak with four storytellers who share their perspective on the story and their role that they play. I'm going to give a brief introduction to each of our panelists, then we'll start the conversation. Although these introductions are brief, we have more information about each of our panelists on the show notes page located at consciousconsumernetwork.tv, and look for the show notes page for episode number 53. There you will find more extensive information about each of our panelists' backgrounds and links to their projects and websites. So, let's jump in. First, I'd like to introduce you to Bio. Bio describes himself as a recovering professor and is the coordinating curator of the Emergence Network, Special Envoy of the International Alliance for Localization. Bio is globally recognized for his poetic, unconventional, counterintuitive, and indigenous take on global crisis, civic action, and social change. Welcome, Bio. This is your second appearance on the For Love of Learning, and we're so thrilled to have you part of tonight's conversation.
Just a thrill to be here. Thank you so much.
You're very, very welcome. So next, I'd like to introduce you to Jim. Jim is a cultural storyteller, educator, speaker, and author. His book, White Mox on the Red Road, describes the value systems developed in Native American cultures many years ago. For the past 25 years, Jim has dedicated his life to learning and sharing Native American cultural knowledge given to him by the elders. Welcome, Jim, to tonight's show.
Thank you for having me, Lena. I'm looking forward to this very much.
You're very welcome. Next, I'd like to introduce you to George. Bringing projects to life that touch people and create meaning in their lives is a passion for George. The last 5 years of his life, George and his family have been focused on creating a sharing economy project intended to meet the needs of people on our planet. George's journey around the world with his family has been dedicated to giving, learning, and constantly growing from his experiences. So welcome to tonight's show, George. This is your third appearance on For the Love of Learning.
Thank you, Lainey. I'm truly grateful to be here. Thank you for having me back again. This is a topic that's really close to my heart and our family's heart. And thank you and welcome to all the guests today.
And finally, I'd like to introduce you to Anna. Anna is a writer, performer, and traveler. She earned her live storytelling chops by sharing stories on stages all over Los Angeles, California. She teaches teen storytelling workshops and is currently working on her first memoir. She is the reigning 2016 Venice Beach, California, Mardi Gras queen. So welcome, Anna.
Hi, thank you. I'm really excited to be here, super grateful, and I'm excited to be a part of a roundtable with other storytellers. Thank you.
You're very welcome. So I want to start the conversation with you, Anna. I'm going to ask everybody on the panel the same question, but let's just kick off the show by answering the question, what is storytelling?
Wow, okay, well, so I feel like there are just as many definitions of storytelling as there are storytellers, but basically, I'll start with what a story is. And a story is a journey, and it's a journey that starts in one place, and it can be a physical journey, an emotional journey, a spiritual, mental, whatever kind of journey you can imagine. And it starts in one place, and then it kind of squiggles all around, and it ends up in this whole different place, right? And at the end, the character has changed and grown in some way. And when I'm talking to my teens in my workshops, I like to tell them that what storytelling is you're telling a story with enough feeling and emotion that it causes the listener's mind to experience that story as real. And so when I think of story, I like to think of those two things kind of squashed together, what the story is, and then the delivery of how you tell it and what it does to the person's mind, the listener's mind.
So that was an incredible way to start off the conversation, Anna, and thank you for that definition. Let's go ahead and jump on over to Jim. Jim, why don't you share with us what you feel storytelling is?
Well, I agree with Anna, number one. Everything she describes is exactly what storytelling is about. Storytelling is the oldest form of communication that we know, other than body language, which would have been used as far back as you can go. But as we started to speak, we started to tell stories. You get up in the morning and you go into the kitchen and you make your coffee and you say, good morning, how was your night? And somebody answers you, they're going to tell you a story. So stories are that simple, and yet they can be very complex. They do so many things. For the people of the world over hundreds of years, all of their education came from storytelling in most places throughout the world. And indeed, today it still does for many. So when they come into a modern educational system, it's hard for them to comprehend how they have to sit in one place and look at a bulletin board and listen to a teacher. But if the teacher's really good, he's going to tell them a story. And I think back to my own education. The teachers I remember were the ones that told me the stories about the history that was going on. And I retained that. Where the things that I studied, I would have a hard time pulling those back. But they're in reference material. A story is giving something from heart to heart. that's the kind of storytelling that I've learned about. When I started telling stories, I didn't think I could do it. The only stories that I tell are the stories I've heard from my elders or my Native American speakers. I've listened to them at the fire. What I found is I can listen to them one time, and they are so intent on the way they're presenting that story and the values that are in the story that I remember it. And I don't think I can remember it verbatim, but when I start to tell the story, it comes out. And it comes out in a way that I can give that story to you into your heart, and you'll retain it. And that's how we pass on knowledge to one another. Knowledge that stays, knowledge about values, knowledge about traditions, knowledge about how we live our lives, what's going on. It snowed today. There's a story. We got 3 inches of snow in New Hampshire in April. That's my story.
I love that you brought up something really interesting. You brought up, first of all, when you said that, when you thought that you had to tell a story, you couldn't do it. And that to me sounds like it's a mental process. But when you said that you started to retell a story from your heart, it was the emotional connection that then allowed you to successfully communicate that story. Do you find that most stories are centered in the heart, the most successful storytelling?
I believe stories are given from soul to soul. Our souls are the spiritual part of who we are. That's that right side of our brain, so to speak. Anna looked to that a little bit as she was speaking. The psychologists and psychiatrists, they say that when people start to hear a story, their mind shifts from the left, the mechanical side, over to the right side. Well, we don't use the right side in this world very often. It's our artistic part. It's our heart side. And so there's a lot of room there to fill up with stories, obviously. But what happens is we start telling the story, and immediately the attention span changes. People focus in, and they're really focused on that story. And they're gathering that story from a psychological standpoint in a part of their mind where they can retain that story over a long period of time and gain the values from it.
Yeah, thank you so much. Bio, I would love to hear from you next. What is your thoughts? How do you define storytelling?
Thank you, Lainey. So I come from a very profound storytelling culture, and that's the Yoruba people from West Nigeria. And I think if you went to Nigeria, if you took a trip to Nigeria and you asked a Yoruba elder to tell you what storytelling is, they will not be able to tell it to you, because we're so immersed in the idea that storytelling is the world, that there's nothing outside of story, that no one will be able to tell you exactly what storytelling is. So I'll just take it from, I'll just piggyback on what James has been saying, and then take a detour as well, that storytelling is how we make sense of the world. You know, we live in a modern world that has created a binary between stories and facts. And so we say, and probably this was one of the weapons in the arsenal of colonialism, that you guys tell stories, but now we're going to bring to you facts. And so to learn about the world, you need to move from this superstitious space and move to these concrete buildings where you learn the truth about the universe. But storytelling has always been the heart of our culture. We even have ways of, Yoruba people have call and response dynamics that are at the heart of storytelling. So you don't start a story, for instance, without saying, "Alo," which is a way to call the audience into being, and the audience responds, our law. You know, it's a dynamic, it's a transaction to say we are here for this. So it's a really powerful, rich, and yeah, a vibrant aspect of the indigenous people of Nigeria. And I suspect all over the world as well. I like to say this as well, that I think storytelling is meeting the universe halfway. So over time, during my academic career, I always thought of storytelling in what some academic histories would name as a social constructivist perspective. That is, stories shape the world. And one of the most popular phrases around that is, the world is not made of atoms, the world is made up of stories. But I'm beginning to rethink that and to agree with the different perspectives that say that the universe also tells stories. Or storytelling is not a human attribute. We don't own that gift. The universe tells stories. Stones tell stories. Trees tell stories in a way that, you know, we can talk about. But these are my initial comments.
Well, you bring up a very interesting point. You bring up the colonialization aspects and how storytelling was taken away from indigenous people as a way to disempower their own cultural identity. And I think later in the show we're going to get into kind of, you know, the balance between those who own history and those who own their own cultural stories. And I'd like to look at that in a little greater detail, but I thank you so much for this beautiful introduction into storytelling from your perspective. Thank you, Bio. And finally, George, please do share with us what your thoughts and feelings are about storytelling.
Well, just the perspective that's come from the three people here, it's touched my heart from the perspective that's the overwhelming thing that's come from me of storytelling is that it is something that emanates from the heart. And what Bayo said about this narrative or dialogue with the universe, I feel that resonates so strongly with my understanding of stories as well, that it's not, that it is an interactive and a process that we basically have with every bit of creation that is in the universe. And for us, from our perspective as a family, storytelling, especially in our journeys, because we took a very different path, and that was really to discover our own story as a family. So storytelling was an integral part of our journey of traveling the world for the last 5 years. And that has come from many different perspectives and understanding, or trying to understand it. One was a very strong influence from the Australian Indigenous people and their storytelling, and what they define as our existence in story. And it inspired our daughter to name her blog Dreamtime Traveller, based on the Indigenous people here of Australia's The Dream. But I feel it is the connective tissues and fibres. Stories are the connective tissues and fibres that connect all of us, a way to get to the authenticity of who we really are, the understanding of who we are, and that includes every part of the universe, as we say, not just the story of humanity, but the story of the universe. So storytelling for me is an integral way for us to connect to that, and for us to also understand what it is and why it is that we are here, you know, as human beings, as a part of the universe, one part of a very connected and interconnected center of creation. So for me, I think storytelling allows us to really connect on that level.
Well, what I love about what you just said, George, is you talk about the indigenous traditions, but you talk about taking these ideas into your modern family, even though you've chosen a very unconventional path, and that then creates stories or a tradition of stories to be told within your family and with those that are coming in contact with you. But what to me is really interesting is how adaptive storytelling then becomes in everybody's lives. As you know, I mean, if this is a very primitive human part of who we are as human beings, you know, we used this tradition and this skill, who knows, millions of years ago, maybe, depending on what you think about how long human has existed. But if we've used it from the beginning and we're still using storytelling now, this is a powerful platform. What I want to know from this panel is, are there specific elements that must be a part of a story in order for it to be a story worthy of being told? So I'll open it up. Jim, you're mute.
That's a hard question. So I'll take a shot, and we'll see what the others think. When I tell a story, I don't think about it in the context of a beginning, a middle, and an end, like you would think of a story that was written in, say, a book. I think of it more as a picture. I think that's how I interpret the stories when they're told to me. I listen to an elder, he tells me a story. The first elder that taught me my stories was my teacher, and he taught me for 25 years. And he's gone now. He's been gone for about 5, 6, 7 years now. But he told the stories from so deep within himself, his voice would change. He'd often tell me the voice I was hearing was his grandfather's voice, and it sounded like it must have been his grandfather's voice. It was a deep Native American deep voice. I'm sitting there, a white man, learning from this Indian, and he's telling me the story. And a couple of years later, when I was starting to do circles and things that he had taught me to do and asked me to do where I am, which was about a long way from where he lived, he came out and he visited, and he went with me one night when I went to do a presentation. And he said, well, what are you going to present? And I said, well, I'm going to present the teachings, the 7 gifts, which are a Native American teaching of the Ojibwe Nation of people. And I said, but I don't know how I'm going to go about it. And I was afraid to tell him that because I was afraid he'd be judging me. He was my teacher, after all. And so I said, well, what do you suggest? And he said, tell the story. Well, the story is the story of the 7 grandfathers, and I'm not going to tell it on a televised program, but I told the story. And I was amazed because I could remember every part of it. At least it seemed like every part of it. And we finished, and we were back in the car and driving back to where we'd come from. And he said, well, you did pretty good. He says, for a while there, I felt like you even sounded like me. And he says, but you left out one part. And I said, I did. And he says, yeah, you left out the part about the otter. Well, like I said, I'm not going to tell a story tonight, but that's one of the most important parts of the whole story. The thing is that in stories, very often, they are packed with lessons. There are teachings all the way through them. And you can tell a story that has been given to you from your heart, and you tell it to one group of people, and you'll tell it a certain way. And then you'll be in another group of people the next day, and somebody out there, for some reason you're sensing, they need to hear something in that story. And you tell the story, but you'll focus a little differently so that you hit that point that you sense somebody is looking for. And I found that if I follow my instincts, I follow my senses, and I do it that way, very often I have people come up and say, that's exactly what we needed to hear. But stories are about values. They're about learning how to live with one another. They're about learning how to respect everything that's around us. And Bale, what you said is so important. Everything out there tells us a story. I didn't understand that in the society I live in as I grew up. But I understand it today because my Native brothers have taught me that. Their language is a language that is pictures, their descriptions. And as I learned to speak their language, I learned that what I was doing is describing an action or describing a scene. And that's what we do with the stories. But that's also what we do when we listen to nature around us with our eyes and our ears, our senses. I'll stop. I want to hear other people. Thank you.
When James was talking, it reminded me of something. I have this wonderful mentor in Los Angeles. His name is Michael McCarty. He's a wonderful storyteller. And I sit down with him all, you know, every time I can. I take him out to lunch and, you know, I just say, tell me all your wisdom about storytelling. And I'll never forget, he just said, Anna, telling stories is like sharing a plate of cookies with an audience or a plate of fruit, you know. They get to take whatever they want, and they can take as many as they want, or they can take none at all. And so you were asking if there's anything specific to storytelling that makes it a story or makes it a good story. I feel like kind of in the technical world, and I've been a real story geek my whole life, but I've really amped it up a lot the past year or so. You know, I read everything I can on stories. I watch videos about stories. I, you know, read everything about how the brain interacts with stories, and I'm trying to get better at telling stories. So you hear a lot when you're learning to tell better stories. You hear a lot about the difference between a story and an anecdote. And so I'll give you that definition. And it's like I said earlier, you know, a story is where the person starts off in one place, but they want to be in another place. And throughout that journey, they grow and they change. And at the end of that story, you know, the characters have learned something or they're in a different place. And an anecdote is just when you've just kind of told, you know, the story. I walked down the street and, you know, I saw this thing happen. You know, that's an anecdote. But for me, I still feel like that's a story because I feel like the whole world is made of stories. I feel like it's like Jim was saying earlier, every single time we wake up in the morning, people say, you know, how was your night? And you say, I had this really great dream, you know, and your dream was a story, right? And it's like Bio said, you know, the trees have stories, the rocks have stories, you know, everything has stories. So I feel like in terms of encouraging people to tell their stories, that maybe to understand that, you know, a classical story, you know, kind of has this arc and all of these things that you have to worry about, and that there is a difference between a story and an anecdote, but to not worry about that in the beginning, to just tell your stories, you know?
I just say a few things about that as well. Thank you, James. It was a pleasure just listening to that. Your stories about telling stories, which is beautiful. So I think Lainey described me as a recovering professor, and I take that description very seriously, because I am trying to recover from my academic training and the whole university system. It so happens that I'm also a clinical psychologist, so the recovering is especially true there. I think stories are indeterminate in the sense that immediately we fix it and insist that this is what is story, we are excluding aspects of what it is or what it could be from mattering. Now, in India, if you walk along the streets, you would probably find a woman early in the morning pouring water on the ground in front of her, then clearing that water on the ground, most probably a concrete ground, with her broom, just clearing it away, just to wash the ground away. And then she proceeds to put rice powder, if I remember correctly, in geometric patterns on the ground. That's called a kolam. And my wife was telling me what kolams are. It's like an invitation to bless for the world, to bless one's family. It's like calling the spirits and the gods and the goddesses and the vibrancy of the planet to just breathe positivity and bring it into one's family. And I remember passing by one day and, you know, my wife telling me the whole deal about kolams. And I felt, now that's a story. That's a powerful story right there. But, you know, we in the modern world are so used to thinking of stories only in terms of its instrumentality to meaning. It's a communicative event. If it's not transacted between one person and another person, then the story hasn't happened. Well, I beg to differ. I think we often forget the very materiality of stories. We could call it the biology of stories. I'll just say this briefly. So this philosopher, this 17th century philosopher called René Descartes, he was the one responsible for the most austere rift in the world today, so to speak. He came up in his book called Meditations, I think published in 1641, with the idea that I think, therefore I am. Everyone knows this, cogito ergo sum. So it's the world is divided, it's split into two, mind and matter, language and universe. And I think that was a most unfortunate split, because we forget that we are embodied. We are what the world is doing. We're not, you know, hovering like holy spirits across over the water. We are the world. We are part of the world. And this also means that stories are part of the world. They're embodied material aspects of the world. So if you were to try to describe story and say stories are made up of words configured in certain ways so that they convey meaning, I think we are blind to the fact that stories could not happen without the movement of our lips, without the environment also taking place, I mean, also being a part of that evocative event. It is just like a blind man walking with a stick and being able to feel the ground, you know, with his cane, but totally forgetting that his feeling is only happening as a result of that cane. We've forgotten the material world that makes storytelling possible. And I think this is really important, especially when we try to answer the question, who is the storyteller? It's very easy today to say human beings tell stories. We are the ones to tell stories. The rest of the world is blind and dumb. Psychologists have a saying, if a tree falls in the forest and there's no one there to hear it, will it make a sound? And I used to tell my students all the time, of course it wouldn't make a sound because there's no human there. But now I'm reconstituting my position on that, because I recognize that the world is much more alive than I previously thought it was. So that stories could be anything. Stories, the very fact that I'm sitting in this chair is a story. It doesn't have to be framed in words. The world is not made up of words. The world is a festival of words and movements and chairs and tables and clouds and seeds. And I think, let me just stop there for now.
Wow, I love what you said, Bio. It reminds me, well, you've used so many metaphors as you speak, and of course the imagery gets ignited in my brain as I can, you know, create pictures, moving pictures, to identify with your words, and it creates emotion inside of me. But what I think of is when I was, you know, in my teens and I wanted to be a dancer, and somebody posed to me the philosophical question, how do you separate the dancer from the dance? And this is kind of the same analogy. How do you separate the story from the storyteller? I mean, it's a philosophical question that it's a path we're going down, and I love it. George, what do you have to say?
Go ahead,
George. I just felt called to that moment. Sorry, brothers. Lenny says, yeah, how do we separate the story from the storyteller, or the dance from the dancer? I think it's impossible to do that. There's a sense in which, you know, the chef that needs the dough is needed by the dough itself. There's a sense in which the writer who writes words on paper is written by those words. There's a mutuality, there's a simultaneity there in that moment, so that it's impossible to parse the two. That was the Cartesian rift that happened. This is the human and this is the non-human world. Whereas the more, you know, we are finding out today that the only way we can become more human is by being part of the non-human world. And the only way we can actually tell stories is by knowing the beautiful silence that, you know, is around the universe. It will not be possible to tell a story without the material world making that possible. I'll just let my brother speak now. There's so much to say and listen to.
Thank you, Bio. I really love that point. I'm thankful for everybody's perspective there. It's so brilliant. But that point, I think, is a really important point to bring up, you know, that whole idea that there could be a dichotomy, a separation of the human experience from nature, from every living thing. I think that goes back to, you know, I love the recovering professor thing. I sort of laugh at that because this whole idea to separate learning out from facts to logic to, you know, and how that has separated us from stories, I think in the Western perspective has very much defined the way how we've become lost and how we've disconnected ourselves from the stories, which I think brings us back to what the element that those stories had, and that is authenticity. They spoke a true language of who we are, where we are going. And I find that in Western cultures today, in particular, and I don't mean to be disparaging of anybody, but we were invited to a birthday party over the weekend, and the people sat around the table and there was this conversation, but in all of that, I really couldn't hear any authenticity. It was this fear of I'll reveal something of myself that I don't want anybody else to hear, so I'll tell this tale. Now, I don't know what the rest of you think, whether that's a story or whether that's not, but it's I feel in this Western sense, the way a lot of people are living, we've disconnected ourselves from this authenticity. I feel we don't even know what authenticity is because we've accepted this dichotomy that we are separate from the universe, that we are separate from the living world, that we're separate from the animal world. And I think that's why we can in so many ways do so much damage to the environment that's around us, to the people that are around us, to the way in which we live. And that's why I feel stories from the heart, that was the other perspective, told from the heart, the very connectivity, you know, I feel that has some sort of connection to the entire universe is a way for us to get back to that authenticity of who we truly are, and to speak those stories, to tell them in that manner is a way in which I think we connect ourselves to the story of all humanity. So I think that's from my perspective. I'll stop there.
Well, with four storytellers here, and I have to jump in, so okay. Please don't be shy.
I just wanted to say something. Thank you so much for that, Georgia, and speaking about authenticity. And I think being authentic is noticing is accounting for all the influences and all the agencies that make storytelling possible. I think it was Thich Nhat Hanh that I wish I had a piece of paper here to demonstrate it. He would say, "What's this piece of paper made of?" And the immediate modern compulsion is to try to delineate, you know, is to try to atomize what the paper is. It's like it's made up of plants pressed together, and you know, all that whatever paper is made up of. But what that blinds us to is, I mean, Thich Nhat Hanh would respond to that, to anyone who says that, is the paper is not just made up of whatever is here. The paper is made up of the clouds, is made up of the rain that touched the soil, is made up of the soil that evoked and called forth a plant, is made up of a farmer's wife that harvested, you know, the plant, is made up of the person who pressed it together. So this is about accounting for all the things that make us. And instead of embodying it in a single boundary, and that's what I'm talking about when I say that stories cannot be determined or cannot be defined in any final way. So in the Igbo culture, for instance, a story does not happen if there's no kolanut passed from elder to elder, if there's no libation poured on the ground. A story doesn't happen. And those very... academic worlds or the Western mind might call that a ritual that clears the path for the story. I say those are the stories themselves. You know, just to be here, just to sit in this chair is a way of telling stories. I might even venture and take a risk and say stories are how we touch each other. And by each other, I don't mean humans touching each other. I mean how the universe touches itself and how it troubles itself and how it evokes newness and makes it happen. I'll let Lali jump in.
I love that description because that describes the relationship of our family. It describes the living, breathing aspect of the relationships that we share together with my wife and our two children, with interacting wherever we are and whomever we are with. It's we view this journey as a story. And every aspect of that is directly related to how we relate to each other, what we feel, what we share, and how we learn. These are the really important aspects for us. Because I share what you say, Bayo, with recovering from this academic sort of way of thinking. You know, I had to suffer the same way, and when I tell that story, I tell to people there wasn't one day in my whole primary and secondary schooling that I actually was happy. I was always tortured by the fact that I had to go. I was sweating, you know, before having to go to school every single day, and I realized, you know, that it was because I was being punished whenever I was wanting to do what came naturally to me, which was to tell a story, which was to, you know, I also liked to entertain, and I found a connection with the people that I was with to do that. And it was always, in the traditional sense, counterintuitive to be in that situation. And we were always punished for that. So we came to a realization very quickly that our story was not going to be defined as a family by us surrogating our children to their education and to the way in which they saw the world and they learnt from the world to other people. We felt very passionate that the story was yet to be told, and it was our story of being together.
That's beautiful, Ellie and Bale. Thank you. I think I became interested in telling stories because I looked around me in this day and age. Now I'm in the United States, so I'm surrounded by my environment or my story, so to speak. But what I saw over the years that I've lived is I saw a great devaluation of society's values, of how we lived with one another, of the respect that we had for one another. And people didn't recognize that they were sharing stories. And our technology has taken us to a place where we no longer communicate, where we're sitting in the same room with one another, even in the show. Things like that that concerned me. And I wanted to find some way to share with others how I felt. And as I learned from my Native brothers and sisters of the stories of their traditions, their history, what they call the creation stories, I found that those stories had webbed through them in a weaving, so to speak. They had a sense of values of how to respect one another, how to respect oneself, how to treat each other, how to help one another, how to help all life. They referred to people, and they weren't talking about human beings. They were talking about people of different tribes, and they were referring to them as the tall ones, the trees, the short ones, the grasses, I see you nodding, and the four-leggeds, the winged ones, the finned ones, and each one being a group of people. And what it did is it put everybody on an equal level where no one was above and no one was below, but we were all equal with one another. And I thought, wow, the way I grew up, that wasn't the way I was raised. That wasn't how I was taught. We were superior. And we were supposed to be able to act that way. We were supposed to be able to take charge of everything else that's on the world and take care of it, which I don't think we've done a very good job, but that's beside the point, not on this topic. But I wanted to find a way to share. Because I grew up in a world where I felt insecure. I didn't feel good about who I was. And I needed help. What I learned from those stories was how to love myself. And then in learning how to love me, I found that the only way I could keep that was to give it to you and to love you. And that the more I gave that love out, and I do it through the stories, the more I give that love out, the more it comes back, to the point it's almost overwhelming. What a gift. And when I look at all of the teachings around the world, not just the Native American, the Judeo-Christian teachings, the teachings of Buddha, the teachings of all of the different beliefs, they all tell us that we need to give out our love. And by giving out our love, it will come back and take care of us. Because we're all one. Bale said that. He related to that and what he was talking about. Everything in this universe is one. We're all connected. We may be in different places in the world, but we're all connected as one. We have that one energy, and we share it through our communication. And our communication in part is the story that we tell, yes. But it's not just the telling. It's being there with that person. It's sharing the vibrations of our bodies, that energy that travels between us. And it's real. It's there. Sharing what we're hearing as we're telling, what we're seeing, what we're tasting, what we're smelling. All of those things come into storytelling. And when you tell that story and you give it from your heart, the beauty is you don't know who's getting it. You're just casting it out. And then you go home and you don't know who really got what you had to say, or even if you necessarily got what you were saying yourself and they got something else. And then 5 or 6 years later, some kid walks up to you on the street and says, I remember you. You're the man that came to our school with a stick and told stories. You made a change in my life. And then you say, wow. Wow, I've helped that one. And that one is me. And that one is you. That's how I perceive storytelling. I grew up, and I know I'm being a little bit long and I apologize, but I want to say this. I grew up in a world where I didn't do well in school. I was a lousy student. I fought the educational system. I hated it. I didn't like sitting in a classroom. I didn't like listening to teachers. Fortunately, I learned to read and I read a lot. I got through my education because I self-read, not because I sat in school. I skipped most of the school I could. But when I started to tell stories and I saw how the kids related, I first started telling them in correctional facilities for juveniles. And I was talking to kids out of the inner city who couldn't read or write and had never spent an hour paying attention to anyone. And I'd tell a story and you could hear a pin drop for 2 hours while they sat there and listened to the story. Wow. And then they remembered what I told them. These were kids that were, as far as the correction system is concerned, these kids were wasted. They were no longer of a value. But they could understand storytelling. And I think that throughout the world, we have a lot of children, particularly ones that come from traditional backgrounds, traditional cultures. They learn by listening to their elders, listening to the stories of their culture. Not by reading it, but by listening and taking it into themselves. And I believe that there are a lot of kids today that would be better off if we could educate them through storytelling rather than trying to educate them in a university with a book. Doesn't mean it's for everybody. But I think there's a place for that, and I don't think we pay enough attention to that. Now I've said way more than I intended to, and I apologize for taking so much time, but I wanted to get that out. Thank you.
Oh, James, it's so beautiful. I felt like you were speaking to my heart, and something that you said reminded me of a reason why I tell stories. And a friend of mine and I, Maria from Sweden, we were roommates in Peru once, and we would sit around and we would tell stories about each other's culture. And one night she got really sad. And she said, you know, there aren't a lot of stories from my culture because people didn't really pass down stories because a lot of really sad things happened in Sweden, you know, a couple hundred years ago. And I felt the same way. I could really relate to her because, you know, just being from a traditional American, dysfunctional Midwestern family, you know, there were a lot of things, there were a lot of stories that my family didn't tell. And that that was a big problem in my life and in my family's life and, you know, in my mother's life and my father's life. And it has affected my family throughout many, many generations, the stories that weren't told. And I think that for me, that's one reason why I like to tell stories. And it's certainly a reason why I like to tell the stories of people who can't tell their stories. You know, a lot of times people say, you know, I'm not a storyteller, but they'll have a really great story. And I'll say, well, can I tell that story for you? And even sometimes just the act of telling a story to another person, it allows them to tell their story. It opens up something within them, you know, so that they can tell their story. But when you talked about stories that weren't told, it just reminded me, it really touched me in a way. It made me remember one of the fundamental reasons why I tell stories. And that's just because sometimes when we don't tell stories, it can be way more damaging. So that's what I have to say about that.
Anna, that's really, I feel that's a really important aspect, you know, that in this society we don't really, you know, in these Western-based societies, I should say, that we don't, we're the prestidigitators of not telling stories, of how we can hide these sorts of things, you know, that it's really led us astray. And as part of our journey we've been traveling, it's sort of also, I want to touch on something that James said, which was really had a profound impact on the storyteller that my daughter has become. And we had this very blessed opportunity to spend time with the people, the Indigenous people of Australia, on the Yunkanjara, Bijanjara tribes in the north of South Australia, they were the deep desert people, and the stories that impacted there had all in our daughter's psyche or in her perception of the world really translated along. And what you said, James, about, you know, the Native American people not having a distinction between the humans being, you know, superior and the animal world and the plant world, this greatly influenced our daughter, who just now in this last week has released her first novel, and it's called Dawn of the Guardian. And in that novel, the protagonist is actually a dog who is who communicates with his master on a telepathic equal level. There's no distinction between the animal world and the human world. In fact, that plays into a very, very important role as the story develops, you know, in how we with the animal world and the plant world and nature and the universe itself and our perceptions of reality and what reality truly is, all are intertwined in this interconnected story. So I really felt that connection too, that we disregard those things in our stories. And I think that's why, Anna, we can get lost in these sorts of worlds of hiding behind things, because we say, you know, oh, it's the only human stories matter. Well, you know, there's so much more depth to the things that are around us in the world. And I think we happily ignore that in the Western world, and we're lost because of that.
Lali, I really like a copy of that novel. If you can tell me where to buy it or something, or you could send me a copy in the spirit of gift, I would love to read a story about, yeah.
I'd happily send all of you a copy after get off here. I can send you an e-copy straight away. So I'd love to gift everybody with that story.
Thank you so much. And you know, what you say is so important. And James, it's a pleasure so much listening to you. Anna, I love the way you brought it together. All this, how this touches me is, it makes it very powerful to me, for me to say that how we tell stories matter. but the stories we tell about the stories, about stories matter as well. I mean, how we figure stories matter. Now, if we say stories are simply, you know, just this very formalized event, is this formalized event between two human beings, we are blind to the way the universe is dancing around us and telling stories. But if we expand our vision, if we broaden the scope and move away from the mainstream, then we can see that there are many streams, so to speak. A friend of mine would like to say that all the time. But I just want to say something about you know, that expansiveness, that sense of justice that still needs to happen. So schooling came to Africa, and its most powerful story was to disrupt our idea of learning, was to take it and encapsulate it and say, now this is learning, and every other thing you've done around you is not learning. It's just, you're just being lazy. To really learn, you need to engage yourself in particular ways and engage certain protocols, and then you would learn. And the reason for that is that the Western mind distrusted the universe. The universe is not immediate. It's not with us. We're not entangled with it. We're over it. And so to access it, we need to struggle to meet it. And, you know, this, and I think this is the connection between storytelling and learning, is we forgot to tell stories. We traded our stories for a single fixed idea. It wasn't even, I wouldn't even call that a story. It was this protocol, this colonized sky that insisted that if you're not in this particular way, if you're not named by us, then you don't matter and you don't exist. And so I think there's a need for us to decolonize our stories today. And that means joining the world in its storytelling. And let me say this. So there's a story about some fishermen in a town called Laguna in Brazil. And these men are remarkable in the way that they fish. Now, the traditional way of fishing, I've never fished before, most of you probably have, but the traditional way of fishing is, of course, to throw your net in the water and get the fish. But these men just stand in the water, and that's it. And I remember watching the clip about these fishermen and wondering, what are they doing, for crying out loud? Why aren't they throwing? Why aren't they doing something? Why are they being passive? And this is even more poignant for me to say, because on Anna's wall, I can see, do more, try harder, start now. And, you know, those are the things I would have loved to say to those men. But they just stood in the water and knee deep in the water and did nothing. But after a while, just spontaneously, or, you know, out of the blue, dolphins just emerged out of the water. And immediately those men took that as a signal and then ran to one end of the beach. And then the dolphins popped up again and went, a score of them just popped up again and went back into the water. And it was as if some story was happening between the dolphins and the men. And 5 minutes later, the men just start pulling in the fish. Now there's no fishing doctrine that would be able to encompass what happened. The fish just came to them, like miraculously, just came out of the blue and came into their nets, almost like the Judeo-Christian story about Jesus telling the disciples to cast their nets, and all the fish came into it. And I remember thinking, when I watched that video clip of fishermen doing the absurd, that if I were to say here that the fishermen were the men, I would be denying the roles that the fish played, that the dolphins played, that the weather played, that the water played in making that possible. And this encompassing this nobility, this invitation to see the world in all its grandeur is, I feel, it's the edge that we need to traverse today. It's the continent that we need to meet today. We need to see stories as, so of course we've all dived into that, as something more than human, as something more than communicative, as something more alive than what we could pass across in novels or in speech or in, you know, story forms. The story form is the planet itself, is the universe touching itself. Yeah.
Absolutely powerful. I'm enthralled in this story. I wonder if the traditions of storytelling from the Indigenous people, from the First Nations people, those traditions are the ones that have been sort of squashed. Those are the traditions that Western culture no longer values. Those are the traditions that we have tried to discredit, and those are the traditions that we try and balance with truth and technology and history and all of those other things. I'd like to know what your thoughts are, and I'm taking this to the panel, about how we can balance both, because I think there is great value in the balance of everything. And colonialization is part of all of it that you're talking about, Bio. You're talking about the history of our humanity with the good, with the bad. James?
It's interesting that you bring that up. And what I'm about to share with you is the history of mankind, because we've all done it to one another over the last 10 plus thousands of years. Learning from my Native brothers was very difficult. Number one, gaining trust with them was nearly impossible. When I first went amongst the Native tribes, I was one of maybe 1,000 people at a ceremony who was a white man. The rest of them were Native American. And that was the first time I ever felt like a minority in my whole life. But over time, I kept coming back. They couldn't figure out why, but I did. And eventually, some of them started to speak to me. Today, I'm very well accepted by all of them. At least I'd say most of them, maybe not all. But I learned a whole lot of things from them. Number one, I learned that the stories that they tell are their creation stories. They start with the story of creation, of the Creator making the universe. And they come all the way up through to today. And they continue with the story of each one of us is part of that creation story. The story of the ant as it goes through its life, the story of the elephant, the story of man, the story of every living thing is part of the creation story. And that in their traditional way, to be one, they have to understand where they've come from, to understand who they are in order to go forward. And in the last 200 to 500 years, the Native American people have had that taken away. But they're not the first. It's been taken away from every culture in the world at one time or another through history. But they're the most recent. In 1890, we took away their rights to do ceremony, their spiritual understanding of how they relate with Creator. So you can't do that anymore. It's illegal. We took away with that their right to gift to one another, because that's a part of the culture, is giving to one another. Is that's like sharing who you are. And it was so strong in our culture that the government said, that's illegal too. You can't do that anymore. And you're going to no longer use your language. You have to speak English. And by the way, we're taking away your name. My native name is Nodin. But they would have said, you can't call yourself Nodin anymore. Now you're Jim. And I'll have to call myself Jim from now on. They took all of that. And the native people said, all the people that came here, all they've done is they've taken things away from us. They took our land. They took our rights. They took our hunting rights. They took everything away from us, which we did. The incurring people that came here. And I had a native man one day, and he turned around to me, and he says, you seem to understand. And he says, but you're a white man. How do you understand this? And I said, I see you like a tree. I see you like a pine tree when the lightning strikes and it rips open your skin all the way down. And the next day you walk by that tree and you look and you say, that tree was just hit by lightning. But 10 years later you walk by and you see that it's closed, but it's still a wound. You can see it. And you say, once that tree was hit by lightning. And 40 years later, you walk by, and you can barely see a crack. To say, a long time ago, that tree was hit by lightning. Another 20 or 30 years come by, somebody cuts that tree down, and they say, you know, when that tree was young, it was hit by lightning. My Indian brothers and sisters, their wound is wide open. They were just hit. I come from the Celtic people of the European descent. My people were hit too, but you can't see my wound. It's too deep within. And a lot of us, we don't remember it. We can't feel it. What my brothers have taught me is how to remember who I am, where I came from, so that I can better understand where I'm going. That's what we have to help each other with. Because we're all in this together. And we all have to help each other to help the young ones that are coming forward. It's no more of this going to a graduation saying, well, we didn't do a very good job. Now it's up to you kids. I'm an old man. I'm 150 years old. But by gosh, I've got a job to do to the last breath of my life. And that's to help the ones that are coming forward to have a better life. We've got a lot of work to do. And the storytellers, they're the magicians, because we're passing it on. And that one seed becomes two, becomes four, becomes eight, and it multiplies out. And those people have that memory. And they may not pull it up for 20 years, but they'll pull it up someday. There I go again. I'm talking all night long.
But it's so beautiful when you talk, so thank you. You're constantly saying things that make me, that light me up and get me going. I went to a Native American dance once, and after every song, we would sit around, you know, around the Tree of Life, and our elder said, now we need everyone, no matter what you saw in your vision, to tell your part of the vision, because you might have gotten a piece over here and someone over there might have gotten a piece over here, and we're like a basket and we're weaving all this together. And so that's how we would come together and weave the basket together. And sometimes one little snippet of the story that spirit would give to you, you know, would make sense to someone else across the room. But to completely kind of jump forward to something else that you said, Jim, that lit up within me. I have a friend who we were walking down the sidewalk one day, and I was I had read too many stories about the earth and how we're really messing up as a steward to the earth, you know, and how you know, we're ruining the earth. And I said to my friend Khan, I said, gosh, it makes me so sad. You know, I feel so overwhelmed as just one little person. You know, what can I do, you know, to kind of fix this? And he said something so brilliant. And that was, and he challenged the way that I thought about everything. And he said, Anna, did you ever think that maybe this is the way that the earth is communicating, that we are just a manifestation of the earth's story? And And it made me think about all the change that's in the world in a much different way. But it didn't give me a license for laziness. Because, you know, you can sit there, you can take it one way and say, oh, well, if this is the Earth story and if this is the Earth, what we are doing to the Earth now is her manifestation of what she wants to happen, pulling the oil out of her, you know, creating global warming and all of that. It could be a license to be lazy, but I feel like the story is unwritten. But I do feel like it is part of the Earth story. And it goes back to what Bio was saying, you know, that's the universe that's telling stories, and it's the universe touching itself. And we're in a really wonderful, precarious, we're on this precipice right now as humanity to go in a whole lot of different ways. It's kind of up to us and the Earth too, the universe.
And it's interesting that you say that, because it evoked in me a thought, you know, that we in the Western world, you know, have this, and I think this comes back to our stories again, this overwhelming, overpowering sense of things that we need to do. You know, we've got to do something, you know. And this is what I sort of took very much from the Australian Indigenous culture, you know, is that it's not always about doing. Yes, of course, there are appropriate times when we must interact with the environment around us. But sometimes, you know, and this is where I wonder, and it goes back to your question too, Lainey, as to, you know, how do we fuse the stories of Indigenous culture with where we are today? And, you know, I think back to the colonists, you know, or the invaders, I say it that way, it's a little bit of an incendiary word, but that came to Australia. And their first question to the sort of, you know, the Indigenous people was that, do you own this land, you know? And they said, no, we don't own this. We're the caretakers of this, you know? And immediately that translated in the mentality of terra nullis, meaning nobody lives on this land, therefore by English common law we can now own this land. And this again was the power or the weapon of this mentality, maybe this way of thinking of ourselves in the world as a weapon to nullify story and nullify our connection with story. I imagine this sort of different approach. I wonder what would have happened to a country like Australia if they got off the boat and instead of asking, do you own this and now can we own it, asking a question, asking them to tell a story. How is it possible that you people have lived on this land which, you know, by our Western culture is so harsh to live on? How have you been able to live like this and how have you thrived? I just imagine Australia being a completely different country had that question been asked. And it comes back to then, you know, because a lot of people would say, well, it's no use us going back to living the way, you know, that is. But I think there's a very, very important point of how do we merge the important aspects of story with the modern way we live, because as James said as well, you know, I see young people sitting around the table in these Western cultures and they're actually, this is what they're doing, you know, their heads down and they're talking to each other at the same time. And in that respect, we are lost. So story presents us with a great opportunity to create our, you know, where do we go from here? And that may be a way in which we can circumvent our, you know, left brain way of what do we have to do next? What do we have to do next? You know, it might give us an opportunity to contemplate what it is, who it is we are and how we interact with the story of the world, the story of the universe, our brothers and sisters, and the living universe around us.
Thank you for that, Lali. I'm the only one calling you Lali and I'm quite proud about that.
I'm happy. It's really my name. Lolly George is my name too, but it's my middle name. So Lolly's, anybody can call me that. It's wonderful.
It's the most sacred name to me. So it's, so there's this author called Chinua Achebe, and he wrote the book Things Fall Apart. He's said to be Africa's first novelist. Very popular. He's late right now, but he literally transformed the landscape of formal storytelling. Great, Lolly. So there's something he said once, that until the lions have their own historians, the history of the hunt will always glorify the hunter. And if there's no greater battle cry for decolonization than those words, the story of a conqueror, you got it. Reading that book itself, Things Fall Apart, is a powerful invitation to notice that our stories are being stripped away from us. So it, like you've pointed out, it's the story of Okonkwo, and Okonkwo, this very masculine figure, this very strong Igbo man that knows his land and knows how to plant yams and knows how to provide for his three wives and take care of all his children. And all of a sudden, all that intimacy with the land, the immediacy with the world, is totally interrupted and disrupted by people coming with their Bibles and with the book and the pencil. And they tell him, now that all what you've done is nonsense. This is where it begins. History starts from now. And Okonkwo is thrown. You know, the title of the book captures it, Things Fall Apart. And the book ends so tragically because Okonkwo hangs himself. And in Igbo land, to hang yourself is to be accursed. It's a way of saying the land itself rejects you. So there's no greater tragedy that could befall a man than for him to hang himself away from the ground where his honor actually lies. And I felt it was a very powerful way to end the book, because we're in that middle space. And I felt the urgency of that middle space as a young academic. I started to become very much aware of the narrative of development and progress and infinite growth and how that was changing my land. I don't speak my language. And I felt, this is all horrible. We ought to decolonize ourselves. We ought to do something about this. So I was this virulent, you know, aggressive oppositional speaker saying, you know, the white man has destroyed us and stuff like that. And we must take our stories back. But I think I was doing a disservice to even our stories by doing that. And this is why, because our indigenous elders would say, to find your way, you have to become lost. And not just that, in times of urgency, they would say, let us slow down. Instead of speeding up and doing more and acting more, recognize that even that which stands in the way is part of the way. That which, you know, disrupts and obstructs and stands as a wall is an invitation for you to reconfigure your notion of continuity, is an invitation for you to, you know, to change your form and become one with the universe in new ways, in new surprising ways. So that has informed everything I'm doing right now. It's and I should say this as well. I think it would, you know, emphasize what I'm trying to say. I was in Richmond last year, Richmond, Virginia, and I visited the Luray Caverns with my wife and my sister-in-law and my daughter, and it's a beautiful, wondrous place. I think there's no greater artwork than the Luray Caverns. It's, you know, if any of you have ever been to a cavern, it's, you know, just like an orchestra of petrified music. Just, you know, pillar here, milky pillar here, one pillar falling on each other. And I noticed that in everything made sense, in spite of the fact that some stalactites and, you know, had fallen down and obstructed the growth of another stalagmite. In spite of the fact that there was chaos in the architecture of the place, it contributed to the whole beauty of everything. It seemed like even when things fell and even when things went awry, it was part of the music that we were being invited into. And I remember telling my wife that this is the story of colonialism. Like we tend to want to fight the enemy, not recognizing that we are the enemy in its continuous mattering. We are, the wound that separates us is the gap between us. And recognizing that we are part of this Gaic story, this Gaic storytelling adventure, is probably worth more than inviting the story of enmity between peoples. You know, recently I read that in Ohio, they've found a way to actually cure cancer using the flu virus. And I think that's very instructive because, you know, one would have thought every form of disease, especially in my Christocentric upbringing, I was raised and conditioned to think of the world as a division between good and bad. So health is good, sickness is bad. If you have the flu, then that's bad, and that's the devil. So get rid of the devil. Let's exercise our demons. But I think, like those Ohio researchers are coming to find out, even that which we've estranged as bad is part of the good. I mean, the flu is now part of a treatment modality. And so, yeah, I think this is justice. This is an invitation to a larger sentence. We have focused on a parenthesized sentence and forgotten the rest of the sentence. This is an invitation to step back and see that the world is so much more promiscuous than any creed that we have. Yeah.
That, what you said, Bio, if I can jump in, especially about Okonkwo and things fall apart. I expressed before about how I really disliked my secondary school. That one novel had such a profound impact on me. It was the only novel out of all of the English books for my exams that I actually bothered to read. The rest and I still managed to get 70-something out of 100 in my thing. But that story of Okonkwo was so powerful, and I remember it, you know, to this very day. And thank you for reawakening that in me. But again, you've just raised another really thing that touches me, and that is that, you know, stories are also a modality for our healing. You know, the words, the way in which they're said, the timing in which they're delivered. I don't know, James, whether you've had that experience with your native brothers as well, you know, that it's not just the story, but the timing in which it is delivered, the words, the way in which they are structured, the way in which they are actually delivered in that timing. Even you use the word disease, you know, and the breakdown of that word, dis-ease, you know, within ourselves, within our bodies. Is sickness a manifestation of the dis-ease that we bring into our lives? And stories maybe can be, you know, such a powerful healing influence on not only our physical selves, but the way in which we understand ourselves and the interconnected nature of our relationships. But I wonder, I'm really curious, James, is the intonation, timing, and the way in which these words are composed in sequence, is that a factor in the way Indigenous storytelling is told in North America?
It very much is a factor. When an elder stands to speak, number one, our best audience is if we can get the people to sit in a circle, on the floor, on the ground, touching the Mother of Earth. And the elder will sit with them, no more, no less, but in the same circle. And he'll stand to speak. And when he speaks, he's speaking from the memory of what he was given orally from his ancestor, from his grandfather, or from his father, or from another elder. And so he's speaking as he remembers that elder having spoke. some of the stories I tell, I heard from Native American people that were in Canada. And so I start telling the story, and every once in a while, you start hearing, "Hey, I want to make you understand, eh?" Because in Canada, they use "eh" a lot. So my verbiage will change because I'm remembering how I heard it. That's how he passed it from his heart into mine. And then I pass it into someone else. The impact of the story is because it wasn't something I read and then regurgitated out as a story. The stories I tell either are stories that have been told to me at the fire, or by an elder at least, or stories that have happened to me as I've walked my path. The path that I've walked is so unbelievable, Lolly. It's just so unbelievable. The things that I've seen, the things that have happened since I started to walk the spirit path of my native brothers. But what it is just a reflection of the past that I came from in my own genetic history. I'm a European mutt. Bale said something, he hasn't kept the original language. And most of us haven't. And 99% of the Native American people, to be honest with you, they can't speak their language. They've lost it. But a few have kept it, and now they're trying to bring it back. Why? Because it helps to reinstate the cultural values of their culture. When the colonists first came in here, they took what they wanted, but they disregarded the culture because in order to recognize the culture, they would have to recognize that the Native American people that were already here were human beings and had rights. And they couldn't acknowledge that and take everything from them. So they disregarded the culture. They looked at the mounds out in the West and they said, oh, the Native American people, they couldn't have built those. Those must have been built by an ancient culture before the Indians. No way. They were built by the Indians. And today we know that. Today our history has gotten a little bit more honest. Maybe not totally, but a little bit. But the thing is, the culture that we overlooked retained all of these values, these social values. Where you came from, where I came from, England at one time, or other countries, we came from villages, and those villages had cultures that have been passed down from generation to generation. No matter where we're from in this world, we all came from an Aboriginal beginning. And those Aboriginal beginnings survived because they had values. And those values were established because there were stories. And those stories told how the people could live with one another. The Native people have a long way to go to get back what they've lost. A lot of Native American people today do not like who they are. They are ashamed of being Indians because they have been made to feel that way over hundreds of years. Other cultures have suffered the same way. It's time to give them back their pride. It's time to give them back their recognition and recognize the beauty of what they have. But in doing that, we're also recognizing the Aboriginal roots that we all come from, that we don't want to look back on because our society today is busy manufacturing, busy being consumers. We're taking kids in India, from some of the native villages. We bring them into the city and we educate them in the private schools and we get them all ready so that they can go to work for Coca-Cola or for IBM. And then they graduate and IBM says, oh, we've got enough employees. We don't need any more. And then we wonder why we got problems out on the street. We've got educated kids that can't go back to their homes because they don't speak their language. They don't know their customs. They're not used to their foods. They don't know how to behave with their elders. They've been displaced. I tell people my native brothers particularly, learn at least a few words in the language. Just a few words. Bonjour. No den indigenous, mang indo den. Anishinaabe, Ojibwe, Bamagana. I know a little bit of the language. It makes me feel like I'm a part of the people, even though I'm not an Indian. But I can speak their language because my teacher told me, I'm not going to teach you unless you learn the language, because everything I teach you loses about 75% of the value as soon as I change it over into English, because you can't do the translation all the way. And that's true in a lot of languages around the world, not just Native American languages. So I tried to learn how to say bonjour, because I know I got a little French, and das, because I know I got a little bit of Russian. You know, I may not know a whole lot of words, but I know a little bit of it because I'm a European mutt. I came from all those countries, and I couldn't tell you how many different countries I come from, and probably from countries in Africa and countries in Asia too. I don't know. My family has been all over this world, so I have a lot of languages to learn a little bit of. But that's carrying forward the culture. My native people would tell you, as long as the drum sounds, we are here. That is the life of the universe, that heartbeat. That's what it's called in Indian. Dwayagan, it means heartbeat, drum. I'm not speaking anymore.
Sorry, go ahead, Anna.
I'm sorry. No, you go ahead. Oh, well, all I was going to say is I just feel like we're all, you know, we're becoming kind of a, you know, we know we're all connected. And we're not becoming a monoculture, but we're beginning to realize that we're all part of the human family, is kind of my point. So I'm going to let Lolly take it now.
Thank you. I think, you know, especially with relation to that point of language, the language that we use, I mean, you know, English is the lingua franca of the world, I don't know if anybody's seen this, but there were some neurophysiologists, some psychologists who did some tests on the way the brain lights up at all when different languages are spoken. And when English is spoken, the brain just practically is like a dead light. You know, there's not that much going on. So I think I feel I don't know if it was conscious, but there was a conscious effort to put away all of the Aboriginal languages, because there is a power in, this is why I sort of asked that question of James. I feel, I have no evidence to this, but I feel there is some sort of power in the Indigenous languages, in the way they're spoken, the way they're composed, the way each word is said. And in a lot of those cultures, the brevity of the number of words that are needed to be spoken to express things, and the way in which they're expressed. And I feel language for us also has been a very important part of our journey as a family. And our children have a Hungarian background, so they learned to speak Hungarian and English. And now we're living in Spain, so they learned to speak Spanish as well. But I feel that language is an important part of the storytelling process, but it's also how we use it, in what timing we deliver it, in which intonations that we use, that has something that might unlock some of those things that awaken things, not just within our brain, but in our brain-heart connection with ourselves and the planet around us. I'm no evidence to that, though, but just a feeling.
Thanks, Lalia. You mentioned some research done with psychologists, and I would really love to see if I could lay my hands on that. I'm So how I feel about that is probably best conveyed by a moment that I shared with when I was a final year student in the university, and when one of my professors spoke with me. He was given a lecture and I was supposed to help out. And I remember he's an English professor. And I remember him saying to me that, you know, Baya, there's no such thing as incorrect English. You know, there's a policeman system in Nigeria, and I suspect, thanks James, in Africa as well, that we kind of police each other to speak good English, especially if you've gone to school. Like, no, that's not how he said. It's not I go to the market. It's I went to the market. It's past tense. That's how to use English correctly, so to speak. So it's like we're constantly debating what is the right way to speak English, and we will go to BBC and learn to structure our lips the way the BBC presenter is doing it, so we can sound just like him, pronounce our words just like him, or how he does it, or how anyone does it on BBC. But my professor told me that there's no incorrect English, because there are many Englishes, he would say. There's the English of that we speak in Nigeria, which is some kind of pidgin. Which is why I'm actually bringing this up, because you mentioned if those researchers worked as if there is some kind of monotonous entity called English, then they would have been denying the fact that even English itself, even if we're to take it for granted that there is a single language called English, then we'll be denying the fact that English is an interaction of many languages, French colluding with Celtic, colluding with so many barbarian tongues, and making that thing happen. So yeah, I just wanted to mention that and say that in the light of what Anna said, I cannot say this or emphasize this enough anytime I speak, and this is the moment where we realize that we are actually, we don't end where our skin ends. We are actually intra-beings. We are intra-connected, not just interconnected. We have no independence as the modern world would have us believe. We've never left the ground. We are so dependent on the ground. We're interdependent on the ground, with the ground, so to speak. There's this small dynamic that illustrates that in evolutionary theory. So they would say biologists discovered some time ago that the story that human beings descended from, you know, if you do know anything about evolutionary theory, it's the idea that human beings were once unsophisticated creatures, and somehow there's a family tree used to illustrate that we kind of broke out from the pack and became this modern human by competing with the environment and surviving. So the survival of the fittest. But biologists are changing that story right now. We're discovering that we cooperated with the non-human world just to get where we are. And it's not like there was such a thing called human that was already predetermined, and all it did was to make a journey and then arrive somewhere. There was the whole tree is the universe, and there is no aspect of it that is, you know, already human, and the rest is the non-human world. The whole tree is human, the whole tree is non-human, so to speak. I hope I'm conveying this correctly. But it's an invitation to see that we are cooperative beings. We are symbiotic beings. We touch each other. We came from each other. We didn't arrive here intact, and we will not get anywhere we're going intact. There's no political structure, there's no vision, there's no cultural story that will take us from where we are to where we would like to be already made out. We are going to be broken down once again. The earth will break us down. It will tease us out, it will pass us into different places, and we will arrive in a different form. And so, yeah, that's the invitation I feel right now. That's justice. That's what justice is turning out to be. We have to learn again to see that we are not separate from the world. Yeah, I think I'll leave it there as well and just sip tea like James.
I love that bio. You awoken in me something that is in our daughter's novel, and without any spoilers, a great part of her stories is from a perspective of a dream world, which is not disconnected from the stories of the real world. In fact, it creates within that sort of that dream environment, and animals create and humans create, and this whole concept of linear time is thrown out the window in her story. I was pretty sort of, when I read it, I was like, oh wow. and I think that's it. It's from those perspectives that if we look at that, you know, a search for meaning, you know, comes, you know, from our collective story, and it's, yes, I don't like to use that word evolving, because I'm not a big believer in evolutionary theory, and our understanding evolves through our stories and the way in which they're told and the way in which they're, as you said, embodied within us, in this embodiment, in this experience. And I think that's a collective experience. And I think there is evidence, you know, that this is, you know, a collective experience of stories told. There are so many authors out there now telling these stories of this collective experience and how we're embodying it. One of the inspirations for our daughter's novel is a novelist by the name of Kingsley L. Dennis. And he is a futurist, and he writes and has co-written a number of books on how our stories are collected, how they come together, and also, you know, how our collective consciousness weaves these stories together into where we are today and where we're going. So that's, for me, a really exciting part of where we're going to as people. I know there's so much doom and gloom with the global media trying to instill fear into our stories, to weave it into almost a DNA level, you know, and there have been actual studies, you know, that show particularly with this 9/11, where women were pregnant and were watching the news when those tragedies were occurring, that it actually in the you know, in the pre-genetic makeup of the children, this you know, this code of fear was basically transposed. So I feel there's another way, there's another side of that coin too, that we need not give in to the stories of fear, and that collectively, you know, as we can tell these stories of our interconnected nature and how we share and how we, dare I say it, evolve, you know, we can basically come to a better understanding that there is nothing to fear, and that there's just some wonderful things that are coming for us, you know, in terms of our story and where we're going.
I hate to be the person to break in to this beautiful conversation that has absolutely all of us inspired. But George, you brought up linear time, and we are about running out of it. I want to ask this panel a final question before we sign off. Quickly, my son and I just got back from being in the Amazon rainforest for 2 weeks, and we were with a group, and everybody had specific interests. And for me, I wanted to learn the stories of the people that grew up there, that you know, the indigenous from those areas. And we learned about the biology, and we learned about the fauna, and we learned about the mammals and the reptiles, and we learned about everything. But what put it into context for me, the way that I had a full understanding of the jungle experience, was these stories that were told about the spirit of the forest and how they created the sounds that the animals make, and how one spirit changed and chased another one, and how now the plants grow in this direction, so forth. And the stories were so powerful that it gave me this complete understanding of where I was standing in that moment. And I felt like I was part of it through those stories. And the final question that I want to ask this panel is, how can we, as modern day storytellers and story consumers, how can we give to that story or contribute and participate in a story that we want to tell and be a part of? And I want to leave this panel off on a high note, because there is hope, and there is, let's let the stories unfold. And I've learned and become inspired by each one of your stories throughout this panel. And that's what I'd like to know. So whoever would like to take that question first, floor is yours.
Okay, can I go? All right. So a couple of years ago, I met with traditional healers, Yoruba shaman healers, priests. And I was studying, completing my doctorate work on indigenous healing systems. And this goes into the earlier story I told of myself wanting to decolonize myself from everything Western, as if I could tease out a pure version of what I should have been. And so I wanted to see if there was a way to circumvent the Western story of clinical psychology, if there are other ways of thinking about mental health and healing and embodiment that we were missing. And I met with these healers, these underground radical healers, which is a very dangerous thing for me to do, because I worked in a Christian university, and everything outside of the Christian mythos is pathologized where I come from, is demonized. So I went underground and met with these men. And I remember speaking with one of them about healing and being alive. And, you know, it was a beautiful conversation. He spoke in my language, which I couldn't understand. So I went with an interpreter. And he, you know, he would laugh at the idea that we could approach healing, or we could heal people with pills alone, like, or all we need to do is just prescribe this pill, a haloperidol or something, or and that's it, and you could heal a person. He invited me to see that the world is so entangled, is a mangled knot, touches itself in effusive ways, in promiscuous ways, that it's impossible to skill or to insist that this is the cause of this or this is the cause of that. And so he invited me to see mental illness, as we call it in the industry, or psychopathology, as a call of spirits, as a gift of the world, as, you know, a dance with the spirit world. It was a beautiful thing to say. It was the first time I had heard anything like that. And I was so grateful for that. And so I dived in more. I dived in deeper. And I invited him to share with me how he thought we could regain this, tell these stories again. And I'll never forget what he said. He said, your roads, your skyscrapers, your cars, and the noise from all of this, your city life, have chased away the spirits to the forest. And they're hiding there behind trees. It is to the dark you must go to find your light again. You have to go to those dark places, to the shadowy places, the cracks and the grooves and the alleys where spirits still live, you know, untouched. And you must speak with them. And those are the people you must connect with again. And, you know, I feel that's an important thing to say, because we are definitely missing some syllables in our storytelling forms. It's not enough to just speak about a story. Even the way, like Lali said, even the way we pronounce words, even the way we approach words as sensuous aspects of the universe, instead of just things that we mouth off, even the way we approach the world is, you know, is an invitation to, or is always exclusionary. It will always cut off some aspect of the universe. And so we must go to those aspects that we've cut off, and we must try to embrace them again. We must have thrilling partnerships with the non-human world. And in doing that, we will learn how to tell different kinds of stories. We cannot sit in the convenience of our chairs like lazy liberals and insist that we can tell the story of the world again from our convenient point of view. We have to do the work of going out there and touching the ground and letting the ground in that moment teach us how to speak. And that's what I'll say in end.
What I'd like to say is to add to what you just said, because I think it's so important. My elder, first question he ever asked me, he said, do you believe in God? And I said, well, yeah. And I looked at him kind of weird, like, don't you? You know, I mean, he's no. But, and he said, I don't know. And I said, well, what do you mean you don't know? And he says, well, I believe there's a God, but I don't know there's a God. But because I believe, it's real for me. I spent 20 years trying to understand what he had shared with me. Today I understand. The hope is within ourselves and what we believe. Our belief is our reality. What you believe is real, but it's not the same as what I believe, and what I believe is real. So what our job is with one another is to respect each other's reality. Then we can share without contrast. Then we can grow together. And each time we share, we walk away with a little more understanding from each other to help our reality become more focused. The end is a word, a native word called Deboiwan. It means truth. And truth means what you were saying a lot earlier, Bale, and that was that understanding kind of what the onion is, the peels all the way down to understand the in-depth of what is. That's what we're here for, is to learn the truth. But we have to understand that we know very little in order to be open to receive new information. So when we start a story in Native American, we started off, I just know a little bit. And I usually started off, I know a little bit of what my elder knew, and he only knew a little bit. Because by only knowing a little bit, there's so much more to come. And then every day is a gift, because every day I get to learn more and more and more stuff, and I get to share it with all of you. Thank you for letting me be on here tonight with all of you. It's been a very great honor. But I'm going to end and listen to the rest of you for a while.
Thank you. It has been a really great honor for me to be here as well. I feel like my brain has grown 10 sizes. But to answer your question, Lainey, and I believe how I heard it was, how can we all participate in storytelling, and how can we consume stories? You know, how do we fit in? And I would say, are you human? Are you breathing right now? Are you alive? You are. And so you can't help it but to be a storyteller. You can't help but to every single bit of information that comes in your brain, every single thing that your eyes see, everything you hear, everything you feel, it's all a story, and it's all, it all has story, and our brains are literally wired for story. I feel like without stories, humanity just wouldn't exist. So my answer would be, if you're alive, if you're breathing, you still have things to learn, you still have stories to tell, and you're still going to be consuming stories. But I think the ultimate thing with stories is it's about how we're all connected. It's about speaking and listening. And as the storyteller, it's about making your focus be your audience. And then they're giving that energy back to you. So that's another way that we're all connected as story and storyteller. And then the only other thing that I would say, and I don't think that we touched on this, I hope that everyone out there is just really aware that, you know, the corporate culture, they understand story really, really well. And they're selling it every day in every way. And some of the stories are good stories, you know, some stories are a little tricky to get you to drink more Coca-Cola or whatever, but you better understand story, because every big entity out there that wants your money, and there's a lot of money at stake with stories as well, so that's another thing. But to end on a positive note, more than anything, it's about the connection, and it's about how just we're all one. So thank you so much.
Thank you, Anna. Thank you to everybody, to all of you here. I feel we are each other's brothers and sisters. I feel that's a really important connection to acknowledge. Our stories help us to connect to those ways in more profound ways. And as we do, we come to get a better understanding of who we are. You're right, Anna, the corporate world and bio, you know, having studied psychology, I lost the faith before I actually even got qualified as a psychologist. But, you know, Freud's, not many people know the story, you know, of Freud's nephew who basically took the human condition from the outside. Edward Bernays took it from how we use stories to you know, manipulate people into doing the things that we want them to do. I see everybody knows Edward, but that's the thing. I think we have to then now, what you know, again, go back to that thing, do, you know, we have to tell our stories from the heart. And there are many studies now that are showing the heart has such subtle neuro controllers that they actually control the brain. They control the way more neural pathways are created within the brain. The things, as you said, Bo, from the, you know, what we understood of biology in the past, it's being rewritten. And I think the stories are the way in which we will completely rewrite our physical, biological, genetic makeup, how we will come to see each other, how we will come to connect with each other and with the world around us in every living aspect of it. So please go out there and tell your story.
Thank you. And I could not have summed it up any better than that. Thank you. This has been one of the most incredible panels that I've had the pleasure to speak with and the honor to speak with. And I appreciate all of you being here and sharing your souls with us. And it's such a great honor. I've been off the air for almost 6 weeks. I've been working doing retreats with teens. I work with them, in a retreat format, doing these learning communities. And I've missed being here. I've missed being a part of this show, and I've missed being a part of these conversations. So this has been, for me, the debut show coming back, and I'm really grateful that it was this conversation. So before we wrap it up, I need to thank Nina, our producer, who always puts together these incredible panels and keeps me inspired, and it keeps us inspired. And I really look forward to looking back on this show and rewatching it and getting more and more inspiration. Thank you, Nina, for that. And thank you, Mel and Biggie over at Conscious Consumer Network. Without you, we wouldn't have a platform to broadcast on. We're so grateful to be able to have these conversations that are on the outskirts of education, but it really is about humanity and our own personal education. So thank you again. Wherever you are and whatever you do, always continue to do it for the love of learning.
Thank you for tuning into CCN. This unique network is dedicated to free and independent media. CCN was created with the belief that information is the common heritage of all beings, which is why our live stream high-definition broadcast is easily accessible and free to view. If we want to change the world, we must first change the media. Having produced over 1,000 shows in 2015, which are all archived on YouTube, we look forward to bringing you more groundbreaking, cutting-edge information in 2016. For more information on what is on, please check out our broadcast guide for weekly updates. CCM broadcasts in multiple languages and features some key voices of our challenging times who are all in pursuit of a free, fair, just, sustainable world. CCM belongs to you, the people, and it is up to you all to keep this network on the air. Please contribute to the Network Support Fund or visit the CCN shop. We thank you all for supporting free and independent media.